Good morning.
Good morning.
A special welcome to visitors and guests. We're pleased that you're here worshiping with us this morning, and we pray that the joy of Christ will fill you as we worship. There are friendship pads near the center aisle on each pew. If you'd fill those out, send them down and back again, it's greatly appreciated. And then please join us downstairs for coffee and fellowship after the service. Well, today's KDIO radio broadcast is sponsored by your gifts to the Endowment Fund, so thank you for your generosity. Next Sunday is installation of our new council members, so please, we'll reinstall the current ones that are continuing their time and install the new ones, so please come and join us for that. Prairie Five and Big Stone Lake Area Food Shelf is participating in the Open Your Heart Summer Challenge. Open Your Heart helps fund solutions to end hunger and homelessness in Minnesota. So please see your bulletin for details on how you can support this vital community ministry. And then thanks today to Becky Parker, who is our today's lector. Is there anything else that we should bring up this morning? All right, please stand as you are able. The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
Please share Christ's peace with those around you. Well, we continue with confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who greets us in this and every season, whose word never fails, whose promise is sure. Amen. So let us confess our sin in the presence of God and our neighbors, and note that there are two times during confession that we'll have a period of short silent reflection. Merciful God, we confess that we have sinned, we have hurt our community, we have squandered your blessings, we have hoarded your bounty. In the name of Jesus, forgive us and grant us your mercy. Righteous God, we confess that we have sinned. We have failed to be honest. We have lacked the courage to speak. We have spoken falsely. In the name of Jesus, forgive us and grant us your mercy. And here is the good news. God is a cup of cold water when we thirst. God offers boundless grace when we fail. Claim the gift of God's mercy. You are freed and forgiven in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. You may be seated as we sing, as we gather at your table. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the companion and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you always. Let us pray. O God, you direct our lives by your grace, and your words of justice and mercy reshape the world. Mold us into a people who welcome your word and serve one another through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
The reading can be found on page 566 of the Old Testament in the Pew Bibles. Through a symbolic action, Jeremiah insisted that Judah and all the surrounding nations should submit to the king of Babylon. This happened in Jeremiah 27. Hananiah contradicted the word of Jeremiah, who in reply insisted that Hananiah's rosy prediction should not be believed until it comes true. God confirmed the word of Jeremiah and sentenced the false prophet Hananiah to death. A reading from Jeremiah, the 28th chapter, beginning with the 5th verse. The prophet Jeremiah spoke to the prophet Hananiah in the presence of the priests and all the people who were standing in the house of the Lord. And the prophet Jeremiah said, Amen. May the Lord do so. May the Lord fulfill the words that you have prophesied and bring back to this place from Babylon the vessels of the house of the Lord and all the exiles. But listen now to this word that I speak in your hearing and in the hearing of all the people. The prophets who preceded you and me from ancient times prophesied war, famine, and pestilence against many countries and great kingdoms. As for the prophet who prophesies peace, when the word of that prophet comes true, then it will be known that the Lord has truly sent the prophet, the word of the Lord. Psalm 89 is found between in the ELW hymnal between the readings and the hymns, and we will read responsively by verse. A reading from Psalms, the 89th chapter, beginning with the first verse. Love, your love, O Lord, forever will I sing. From age to age my mouth will proclaim your faithfulness. For I am persuaded that your steadfast love is established forever. You have set your faithfulness firmly in the heavens. I have made a covenant with my chosen one. I have sworn an oath to David, my servant. I will establish your line forever and preserve your throne for all generations. Happy are the people who know the festal shout. They walk, O Lord, in the light of your presence. They rejoice daily in your name. They are jubilant in your righteousness. For you are the glory of their strength, and by your favor our might is exalted. Truly our shield belongs to the Lord, our King to the Holy One of Israel. The word of the Lord. The second reading can be found on page 119 of the New Testament in the Pew Bibles. Sin is an enslaving power which motivates us to live self-serving, disobedient lives. Sin's final payoff is death. We, however, have been set free from sin's slavery to live obediently under God's grace, whose end is the free gift of eternal life. A reading from Romans 6, the sixth chapter, beginning with the 12th verse. Do not let sin exercise dominion in your mortal bodies to make you obey their passions. No longer present your members to sin as instruments of wickedness, but present yourselves to God as those who have been brought from death to life. And present your members to God as instruments of righteousness. For sin will have no dominion over you, since you are not under law, but under grace. What then? Should we sin because we are not under law, but under grace? By no means. Do you not know that if you present yourselves to anyone as obedient slaves, you are slaves of the one whom you obey? Either of sin, which leads to death, or of obedience, which leads to righteousness. But thanks be to God that you, having once been slaves of sin, have become obedient from the heart to the form of teaching to which you were entrusted, and that you, having been set free from sin, have become slaves of righteousness. I am speaking in human terms because of your natural limitations. For just as you once presented your members as slaves to impurity and greater iniquity, so now present your members as slaves to righteousness for sanctification. When you were slaves of sin, you were free in regard to righteousness. So what advantage did you get then from the things of which you are now ashamed? The end of those things is death. But now that you have been freed from sin and enslaved to God, the advantage you get is sanctification. The end is eternal life. For the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus, our Lord. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. I know we have just a couple of kids here this morning. Did you want to come forward for a children's message?
No.
Thank you for coming on up. We'll have you sit here. Do you know what frisbees are?
Yeah.
Right. People and dogs like to play with them, right? Yeah. Well, once the chairman of the company that makes real frisbees wanted to do a good thing, so he sent thousands of frisbees to an orphanage in a country in Africa. So he thought the children there would enjoy playing with them. Well, several months later, a representative from that company visited that orphanage, and one of the nuns thanked him for these wonderful plates that his company had sent him. She told him the children were eating off the plates, they were carrying water with them, and they were even catching fish with them. Yeah, who would have thought? So when the representative explained how the frisbees were really intended to be used, to be thrown and played with, the nun was even more delighted, because that way the children could also enjoy them as toys. So the children and the nuns welcomed this unexpected gift. It made a big difference in their lives, even if it wasn't used as it was originally intended. Well, Jesus tells us to welcome people and the gifts that they give us. So we too are to welcome people and share God's love with them. So can you think of ways that we can welcome people? What can we do? I'm sorry? You could help them? How about if we just say welcome? That would be a way, right? Could we smile? Yep, that would be a way of welcoming them. How about if we shake their hand? Did you shake hands this morning earlier? Yeah. Or we could even give them something cold or hot to drink. That would be a good way to welcome. Yeah. Well, let's try to be welcoming to the people that we meet. Well, should we pray? Can you repeat after me? Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
For welcoming me.
For welcoming me.
Help me to welcome others.
Help me to welcome others.
In your name.
In your name.
Amen.
Amen.
All right, we make the sign of the cross here. Do you know how to do that?
What?
We make the sign of the cross. Can I show you how to do that? You want to stand up? Well, I'll stand in front of you. We go, God in my head, God in my heart, God on my left, and God on my right. All right, thank you for coming up. You can go back to your seats. And this morning we have special music as I Will Arise by Paula Tobin and Jenna Schulte. Thank you. Please stand as we welcome the gospel by singing the Alleluia. The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 10th chapter. Jesus is speaking to the 12 disciples. Whoever welcomes you welcomes me, and whoever welcomes me welcomes the one who sent me. Whoever welcomes a prophet in the name of a prophet will receive a prophet's reward, and whoever welcomes a righteous person in the name of a righteous person will receive the reward of the righteous. And whoever gives even a cup of cold water to one of these little ones in the name of a disciple, truly I tell you, none of these will lose their reward. The Gospel of the Lord. You may be seated. Well, grace and peace, beloved, from our Lord and Savior who welcomes all, Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, welcome. It's a word that's used freely and abundantly. Every business, church and individual like to think of themselves as welcoming. Well, even Jesus tells us to be a source of welcome. It's a core value of Judeo-Christian believers. Well, we want to welcome friend and stranger alike to our house of worship. It's one of the reasons we have greeters meeting people as they enter the sanctuary for worship. We have ramps and better lighting and directional signs to welcome the stranger. We all know how good it feels to be welcomed, especially in an unfamiliar space. Well, seminary students in their clinical pastoral education, which often takes place in a hospital, are told right from the beginning that when you enter a hospital room as a chaplain, you are representing Christ. So Christ alongside you, behind you, following you into the room. So yes, you bring yourself, but you bring the entire church with you. Well, Jesus is telling his disciples the same thing now that they're being sent out in mission. As his disciples and representatives, they are now carrying the identity of Christ. So when they preach, teach, and heal, it is Christ's work that's done by their hands. The world will meet Jesus through them. Whoever welcomes you welcomes me, and whoever welcomes me welcomes the one who sent me. So when we welcome one another, we welcome Christ and therefore God into our lives. And who does Jesus welcome? Well, Jesus' welcome spends time with, forgives, heals, and transforms the least, the lost, the forgotten, and all those others not considered good company. Well, today it might mean welcoming those we are prejudiced against, those we are awkward with, those we fear, real or imagined. Jesus tells us to welcome those who don't fit into society's idea of normal. Jesus isn't concerned about how uncomfortable you are or how uncomfortable you may feel. Instead, it's a privilege and a responsibility to make Christ visible in the world. we are to responsibly steward what we've been given, a welcome by Christ. So by showing hospitality and welcome to the most vulnerable in our society, we are welcoming Christ himself. Well, Jesus is telling his disciples to go into the surrounding areas, go into the world. It's that same directive for us. We cannot reflect the love of Christ if we stay home among those we know. Since Christ was made visible in the act of welcoming, in giving and receiving hospitality, if we never encounter strangers, Jesus has no opportunity to be made evident and welcome. Well, carrying the burdens of the past restricts our ability to welcome the present and hope for the future. At the same time, remember the God who has been faithful throughout our biblical history, embodied in the life of Jesus, God's work and word lived out in the world. As disciples then and now, we follow this way of Jesus. You who were baptized in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit are Jesus' disciples. You who have been instructed and formed in your faith journey are his disciples. All of you, not just the pastor, all of you have been set apart for the sharing of the good news of Jesus Christ resurrected. And sometimes that's as simple as offering a cup of cold water. Well, we don't like to see ourselves in need, but all of us are needy at one time or another. We don't have the threat of life or death struggles of the first disciples, but we do face cultural indifference that kills in another way through discouragement and the tedium of living out our life of faith. Yet this is where Jesus promises gifts of grace. Jesus is speaking to you, to all of us. Christ is not only visible in the other, in people outside ourselves. We see Christ in us. When we look in the mirror, we see Christ looking back at us. Made in the image of God, we reflect Christ's light in the world, even to ourselves. Well, after telling the disciples of all the trials and the challenges of following him, Jesus now gives them a word of encouragement. These promises of welcome are for them. As they bear and bring the gifts of God to those that they encounter, they will also receive gifts of welcome along the way in small ways, even a glass of cold water. To continue, gives them encouragement to continue to the places and people that they are called. We are to know that even in our suffering, there will be gifts of God's grace. Well, we've all experienced them, even though we may not recognize them as such at the time. It might have been a concerned or encouraging word, a warm meal that fed body or soul, an unexpected note that renewed your faith. These are what Jesus encourages us to take when you are weary and disheartened. Receive this gift. This hospitality, he says, it's a sign of God's favor. It comes with healing in its wings. Rest and be welcomed. Let yourself occasionally be the cherished guest for Christ's sake and in his name. Well, there is a gift in remembering that we are called to see Jesus and those we are called to welcome, as many have done for us. It's what strengthens us for what God has called us to do. Even though it may seem small, that cup of cold water, a quick hug, a standing alongside, a reminder of prayer, a word of encouragement, a listening ear. They make all the difference. And it is what God's intent was all along. Well, Liddy Barlow, the executive minister for Christian Associates of Southwest Pennsylvania, laments the divisions in Christ Church, as do many of you. She states the petty squabbles and genuine grievances have distracted us from our mission, squandered our resources, broken hearts, and ruined lives. It's a tragedy that we cannot come to one communion table, a shame that our belief in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church remains an abstract ideal. Our divisions make us strangers. Yet Barlow can see a blessing in this brokenness. She lifts up a word of hope that because we are strangers to one another, we can welcome one another. Because we are not yet at home with one another, we can extend hospitality. And so in that hospitality and welcome, Christ is present in our midst, in the face of our fellow Christians, as we bear God's image to one another. So as the seminary students are taught, we are reminded once again, Jesus is alongside us all the way. That indeed is a blessing that we can all acknowledge and appreciate. Amen. I invite you to sing All Are Welcome, number 641 in the back of the hymnal.
Thank you.
Please stand as we profess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated for the prayers. Trusting in God's abundant mercy, let us offer our prayers for a world in need. Each prayer petition ends with God in your mercy, and your response is hear our prayer. We pray for the church, for wisdom to heed the voices of prophets in our midst who cast a vision of God's promised future, for courage to welcome people whom society rejects, for resolve to serve all in need. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for creation, for all rivers, lakes, oceans, and streams, for lands experiencing scorching heat, drought, or wildfires, for conservation organizations and environmental activists, for scientists working on clean energy solutions. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for this nation and all nations, for national elected leaders and presidents, governors and legislatures, for judges, juries, district attorneys, and public defenders, for military personnel, for those who are incarcerated. Guide us in ways of freedom that promote the common good. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for those in need, for exiles, immigrants, refugees, and those seeking asylum, for victims of harassment, torture, or abuse, for those who are ill, especially Ricky, Carol, Glenn, Arlen, Gail, Harris, Brandy, Clara, Paul, Beckett, Jerry, Baby Rosie, Larry, Natalie, Baby McCoy, Zane, Brian, Janice, David, Jerry, and Terry. At Fairway View Neighborhoods, Janet, Arvilla, Ruth, Jim, Vivian, and Eleanor. And for any near death and for all who grieve, God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for children, for their safety at home and in childcare settings, for their flourishing at summer programs and camps, for the many people who care for them, including parents and grandparents, child care workers and teachers, coaches, counselors and mentors, pediatricians and psychologists. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We give thanks for all the saints and prophets who have received the free gift of God, which is eternal life in Christ Jesus, our Lord. May their lives of humble service inspire us in faith. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Receive our prayers and answer us, O God, in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. At this time, we ask the ushers to collect and present the offering as we sing our hymn, O God, Beyond All Praising. Let us pray. God of field and forest, sea and sky, you are the giver of all good things. Sustain us with these gifts of your creation and multiply your graciousness in us, that the world may be fed with your love through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. I invite you to stand for the great thanksgiving. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior, Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so, with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And again after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated. All people are invited to Christ's table. All are welcome. So come, eat what is good. And for those of you watching online, the body of Christ given for you, the blood of Christ shed for you. So communion assistants, please come forward as we sing Lamb of God and the distribution hymns. Please stand. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Let us pray. We thank you, generous God, for the refreshment we have received at your banquet table. Send us now to spread your generosity into all the world through the one who is our dearest treasure, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Receive the blessing. The God who calls across the cosmos and speaks in the smallest seed, bless, keep, and sustain you now and to the end of the age. Amen. So, people of God, go in peace, share the harvest.
We will.
Thanks be to God. You may be seated as we sing, O Beautiful for Spacious Skies.